To give my talk here at this conference in honor of Yuri. And I will start by recalling Yukabanov's exchange cone model. So this model has two main ingredients. So one is P integrable X in RD, and the second one is a random cone. And it's generated by some, for instance, exchange rates on different currencies or different assets. And for me, K is the cone of portfolios available at price zero. So the orientation maybe is exactly the opposite than the solvency cone. So K describes transaction rules at the time when the gain X is assessed. So to say, the picture looks like this. Or maybe better like this. Okay. And the aim is to assess the gain, the risk of X, taking K into account somehow. Well, so this idea of solvency cones and cones in relation to multivariate finance actually opened the connection to convex geometry. And this explains partially the reason why I am doing this. So the first temptation is to measure the risk of X by some vector. So imagine we want X as a vector, so why not to let Rx, risk of X, be a vector too? And then the natural assumptions are completely well known. So cash invariance, monotonicity, one can impose homogeneity and subadditivity just to be on the safe side. But then somehow the outcome is disappointing. If R satisfies all these assumptions, absolutely natural assumptions, then there's only one possibility for R. R is marginalized. So the risk of a vector consists of risks of all components of the vector, just assessed individually by individual risk measures. So that's somehow says, well, no, there is no chance to measure the risk of vector with a vector of the same dimension. One can obviously pull the coordinates together and then come up with a single number, and then the coordinates are mixed. But then obviously this property is a bit different, but not of the same dimension. Well, that's why that comes opens the next slide. And where we see that the capital that makes a multivariate position acceptable can be chosen in many ways. And these ways are not directly comparable. So in my understanding, once we lose the complete order and go to the partial order, so the appearance of sets is absolutely unavoidable. So one really has to accept that the risk of a multivariate position is a set, because the elements of this set are not comparable with each other. And so the sets which measure risks are upper. So upper set means that if y is greater than x and x belongs to f, then y also belongs to f. And the position is acceptable if the risk contains the origin. Really, if this A, the capital A, which makes x plus a acceptable is zero, then x is acceptable itself and there is no need to add anything to it. And the larger set means lower risk because there are more options to add capital to x to make it acceptable. So this is a sort of the general understanding of set valued risk. There is a previous work on this. And so Hamel and Heidi and Hamel with co-authors some years ago derived dual representations for the risk mirrors of x plus k. So it was conical setting, vector plus a cone. Then there was a work on dynamical setting by Bentahar and Lepinet and Feinstein-Rudloff. And myself and Ignacio Nachakaskas derived primal representations based on selections. So this is what I am going to follow, and I will explain the differences between different approaches. But what is the most important, all previous work has been done in a convex setting. So no non-convexity was present. So now let's move on and to the next stage. So far I explained that the value of the risk measure is naturally a set because it consists of lots of possible capital positions which can be added. But now I make the next one. So the argument of the risk measure should also be a set. And the reason is, well, it's not always point plus a cone. The argument can be of a general nature, and we'll show you examples in a second. So part argument of a risk measure is a portfolio, which is a random convex closed set, or maybe not convex. So convex is probably not is the wrong word, so it's a residual of all previous work. And which is lower set? So for instance, the set like this is lower. So with each point, it contains all other points which are less than it in the coordinate wise order. Well, but the risk is an upper set, and one can talk about utility is a lower set, it's the opposite of the symmetrical set to the risk. And X is no longer, not necessarily convex, so the word convex should be deleted. Now, I will try to justify why set-valued portfolios are reasonable in this relation. So, first it can really incorporate rather general liquidity restriction. And in the simplest case, it is X plus K, which is a Kabanov's model. But the necessity to work with set-valued arguments really is absolutely clear in the dynamical setting. So for standard numerical risk measures, so the standard way is to substitute the value of the conditional risk measure times S into time T risk measure. So if one wants to do it in the set-valued case or in the multivariate case, one absolutely has to substitute set-valued argument into a function. So iteration is not possible otherwise, or becomes awkward otherwise. Well, and the minus F is central symmetry. I quite often use this notation. It's a central symmetric set to F. Well, now what might be more general liquidity restrictions? So let's go beyond Kabanov's model. And for instance, if one-to-one transactions at the exchange rate one-to-one are admissible up to a certain amount, then I can go from X some distance to in this direction and some distance in that direction. And one gets a sort of a set of portfolios like this. Or maybe if transactions that lead to solvent positions or disposal of assets are allowed, then from X I can go only to the positions which are shown here. If X is not solvent itself, then it's only possible to dispose of assets. So there are many other models which lead to convex results, which however might be non-linearly dependent on the position X, but still can be described as set-valued portfolios. But let's look at the non-convex case. So this is a standard picture of portfolios available at price zero when transaction costs are fixed and otherwise the exchange rate of a one-to-one is exactly one. So kappa is the amount of fixed transaction costs, and this is a set of portfolios available at price zero. And if I now add this set to X or shift it translated by X, then I get a set-valued portfolio which is non-convex. So it appeared already in the first talk by Emmanuel at some stage. And One can argue maybe one can use a liquidation function to describe it, but the advantage is not immediately clear because liquidation function also becomes rather awkward and non-convex, and really not, to my understanding, there is no much gain in it. Or one can imagine that only it's possible to do nothing and stay at x, or there are two available transactions that can be applied only once. So I can move from x somewhere here or somewhere there. This is also a non-convex set, which describes possible positions. Well, now let's describe the tool which will be used to assess such risks of such sets. Well, so this is the most important concept of a selection. A selection of a set is a vector which almost surely takes values inside the set, in the set. So Xi belongs to X. And because my risk measures will be defined on p-integrable positions, then I assume that X contains at least one p-integrable selection. And LPX is a set of vectors which are p-integrable and which take values inside X. So an NTP is 1 to infinity, or whatever is needed. It can be generalized for more general spaces, but I really don't care about it at the moment. And I work with a tuple, d-tuple, of univariate monetary LP risk measures, which are defined on LP space. I don't assume, if needed, I assume something more, but generally, only monetary properties is assumed. And so it can be value at risk, for instance. A collection of value at risks may be at different levels. And the random set X is regarded as acceptable if it possesses at least one acceptable selection. So if there is a point Xi inside X, such that the risk of Xi has all components which are at most zero. So all components Xi 1, Xi d, all components of Xi should be acceptable with respect to the relevant risk measure Ri. Well, so this is important to digest, and so X should possess an acceptable point inside. So let's look at the cones. So X plus X bold face, which is X standard plus K, has an acceptable selection if and only if there is a selection of K such that Xi, which is X plus eta, is acceptable. Eta belongs to K and so represents a transfer. So it means from X, one can go somewhere, obviously along these lines. There is no point, no reason to go inside. So one really should follow the border of the cone. And such that after move from X somewhere, after adjusting X to become a different point, it becomes acceptable. Well, so there is equivalent definition in LP spaces. So if A is a family of acceptable positions, then portfolio is acceptable if this intersection of all F measurable selections of X and A is non-empty, or maybe the sum of two sets contains zero. So it's possible to get more LP space variant of this thing. And now the next step is to arrive at a risk measure. And the risk measure is the topological closure of the set of all capitals A, such that the addition A to X makes it acceptable. There is absolutely equivalent definition. So R of X is the closure of the union of upper quadrants. So R Xi plus R plus D is the upper quadrant, which is generated by Xi. And one can look, zero is inside Rx. If and only if, up to the passing to the limit, zero is inside one of these quadrants. and zero is inside one of these quadrants if R of Xi is component-wise at most zero. And this can be viewed as a primal representation of risk measure. So the dual representation is something else, and I will talk in the next slide about it. So now let's think about the dual variant of this. So in a conical setting, it is due to Hamel and co-authors. And so for convex X, for a convex set, there are two ways to look at the set. One way is to look at it as a union of singletons, as a primal representation, or the intersection of half spaces, which is a dual representation. And correspondingly, if you pass this rough idea to risks, one can regard X as acceptable if all half spaces containing X are acceptable. And this essentially is a dual representation of X. And HXU is a support function of X. So it's the maximal extent in direction U extent of the projection of X in direction U. So in this case, the acceptability of portfolio is derived from the acceptability of the support function. And for convex sets, the two approaches are both viable, although it's not always clear if they lead to the same results. But for non-convex sets, the duality approach is not viable at all because it converts X to its convex hull. Now let's look at possible examples. The first example is a set of fixed points. If all components of R are negative of essential infinum, minus essential infinum, should be here, then R of X is minus Fx, where Fx is a set of points which belong to X capital almost surely. So it's a set of fixed points. And this is a sort of minimal, the worst selection, worst risk measure in a set weighted setting. Minus Fx is a subset of any other risk measure. In the other opposite is the negative expectation. So the first, if I take all integrable selections of X and the expectations that the closure of this set is called selection expectation of X or Aumann expectation of X because it is related to Aumann integral defined in 65. And it exactly arises if R of Xi is minus expectation of Xi. This is a vector and this is a vector. And in this case, the selection risk measure becomes the negative of the expectation. So it is linear and it is always convex if the probability space is non-atomic. No matter if X is convex or not. And this, in this case, the primal and dual approaches yield the same set. Well, and we will see this will be a rather exceptional situation. And the expectation immediately paves the way to construct a multitude of other nonlinear functions which satisfy the right risk assessment properties. So one, for instance, is the expectation of the intersection, which corresponds in the numerical case to the expected minimum of IID minus expected minimum of IID random variables, which is also one of used risk measures. Or one can take weighted intersection of weighted expectations, where zeta is the weight, is a family of Q integrable random vectors, and one takes the intersection of it and it remains that of the representation of risk of usual risk measures. Well, so this is a reminder of the definition of the selection risk measure, because now I want to pass to its properties, which are also in the non-convex case. Well, so, and the properties are most natural. So first of all, we always have cache invariance, we always have monotonicity. Monotonicity doesn't reverse the direction. Because if X is subset of Y, Y has more capital inside. And it should have lower risk. And the lower risk means larger set. And the other two, number three and number four, depend on the properties of underlying decouple of risk measures, which is used to construct R capital. So for instance, this decouple consists of homogeneous risk measures, and the result is also homogeneous. If it is convex, then the result is also convex, but convex in the sense of maybe super additivity. But it's really the issue how to order the family of sets by inclusion or by reverse inclusion. And then obviously the terminology changes. But that's why I'm writing super additivity for inclusion. And the larger set means lower risk. And so in the univariate case, even in the univariate case, it fits the usual perception. So if X is p-integrable, then the corresponding set is the half-line which ends up at X. And all selections of this half-line are worse than X. So the selection risk measure is the usual half-line, but in the other direction. So it's all fits together. Now, it's generally a serious task, or almost on task which is not possible to perform, to look at all selections of a random set. There are too many of them because they, on any reasonable sigma algebra, there are really huge number of selections. And it's important somehow to understand which points of X are reasonable to take and which are definitely should be avoided. And obviously in this case, the points which are reasonable to take are Pareto optimal. So I denote these Pareto optimal points as delta plus X. And these are red points which are shown here. And this is the first step. And the set X is called quasi-bounded if the norm of this set, of the Pareto optimal set is bounded. So, for instance, this one is quasi-bounded. Now, let's talk about the issue if the values of risk measures are convex or not. So, recall the simplest one, the expected, negative expectation. And it's always convex, no matter if X is convex or not. And the reason for this lies in Lyapunov's theorem. So Lyapunov's theorem says that if we have a measure and the values of the, well, in one equivalent form, and the values of the measure belongs to the d-dimensional space, then the range of this vector measure is necessarily convex. So that's why, that's actually is nearly the whole proof of the convexity of the expectation. But now, for risk measures, one needs a variant of Lyapunov theorem, which refers to different reference measures. So basically, one has not a vector-valued measure, but a measure whose values correspond to each possible choice of the weighting of the new reference measure, which is choose to weight the expectation. And this space is not finite dimensional, this is infinite dimensional. And Lyapunov's theorem breaks down in infinite dimensional spaces. There are some cases where it still works, but really none of them fits the needs of the risk measures, of exactly the risk measures. So what happens then, something positive? So let's look at example. So X are 2 points plus negative quadrant. Then the convexity, then the result is convex, if and only if we have really strange and new property of the underlying numeric or vector valued risk measure. Namely, the convex combination is greater than the value of risk measure at some combined xi and eta. So, which is apparently this property has not been explored, and I can't say anything more in its relation. But now, in which case we have the convexity, and this happens if we imagine we have representation of R of xi, supremum as the usual one, R is convex, and then the result, the risk measure on atomic probability space is convex if this penalty function is nearly always infinite. So essentially only a finite number of this supremum becomes maximum over a finite set. So in this case we have the convexity. Otherwise it's completely unclear. But even in deterministic case, in sort of set of convex geometry setting, one gets some kind of new concept. So imagine we have deterministic set F. And it's not guaranteed that the risk of F is minus F. So the risk of a deterministic non-convex set might not be the set itself. So it might be convex hull or something in between. And this is, so F is called R convex if for all two points in F and all possible partitions of probability space, the risk of the resulting selection belongs to F. So this convexity satisfies the usual convexity properties, the intersection of convex sets is convex. And so each lower closed set is convex with respect to S-inf risk measure, and transaction costs are convex for average value at risk for alpha less than 2. Well, so next result is about low invariance. So basically one can read the statement, so R of X is low invariant under a rather mild condition. So we need quasi-boundedness, so that the set of Pareto optimal points is bounded, and the underlying risk measure should be Lebesgue continuous. So which is still possible to assume. So for convex and coherent X, it's always the case. So I skip the proof. And now I quickly talk about fixed transaction costs and bounds. So fixed transaction costs, there are two bounds on the set of x plus eta k. One is bound is possible to go along this line, and the other bound is possible to go along blue line. And this creates, well, in a sense, one has to be able to assess the risk of the half space. But this seems to be easy, but actually there are pitfalls on the background. So if the underlying risk measure is coherent, then the risk of the half space is actually the risk of the sum of vectors of this point. From X, it's almost possible to go to the point of intersection with one of the axes, and then it's always all right. But as soon as this is no longer the case, one gets completely new situation. For instance, if all components are convex, then what actually is important there? So it's not really always working, the pointer. And what always working there is d times rd over sum over a dimension. So which makes R a sort of homogeneous. And but only if all components are the same. And if components are not the same, I only know some partial answers. Well, and to calculate the selection risk, one can use some really simple bound because it's super additive. So, and if X is X plus F for deterministic F, like for fixed transaction costs, then R of X is more than this R of X, which is easy to calculate, and the risk of deterministic set. So one has to treat deterministic sets case. And so let's look at two examples and in the remaining 2 minutes. So for fixed transaction costs in dimension 2, And imagine we have R with coherent components. Then basically we need to know what is the set of risks of indicators and minus indicator. What is geometry of this set? And so if R is the average value at risk at alpha at most 1/2, then the risk is minus IK. But otherwise, for alpha more than half, it is not. So we have the curve, which sort of reminds that of the minus I, and it's analytically calculated. It's not numerical result. It's really more or less having a closed form formula for it. And with alpha growing, this red line goes down. And after all, with alpha equal 1, it becomes the line bisecting the second and the fourth quadrant. And another example, the last example. So for two possible transections, so deterministic transections, imagine x is here, and so there is either possibility of do nothing or to exchange for x minus y, then the risk is this red set which is non-convex and which is polygonal line connecting the opposite point to x minus y and zero in some analytically tractable manner. However, once one gets rid of deterministic set, and once one wants to do some random variant, then the analytical calculation are really prohibitive, and the numerical calculation are prohibitive either. So essentially, it's extremely difficult to produce any exact results in this case. So here are some references for papers of Hamelin co-authors and some one of myself and Kaskas. And so with this, I want to thank you for attention and wish happy birthday to Jura and close my talk.
Thank you. So we have time for some questions. So questions?
So yesterday we followed the talk about a bit more general model, namely von Neumann-Gale stochastic model. In fact, this model is a bit more general. The dynamics is not given by increments, but a pair xt minus 1 xt. And so this economically interesting model probably has also a certain counterpart or development in the spirit of what you just said. What is your opinion on this?
Well, first of all, this all was static, so I didn't talk about any dynamics. But imagine one has on the background a vector, so a position is vector valued. And then one takes the conical case, x plus k, and this is what I called x bold phase. Now, in the Gale, von Neumann-Gale, Gale variant, from x, one goes somewhere to a of x. I use the same notation as yesterday. And this is a set valued function of x. Right? Well, so this works perfectly. And so if I take A is the family of transactions of capital, so that A, x plus A is acceptable, it works all right. And so in this case, A, x plus A plus K is acceptable is much easier because in this case a of x plus a is a of x plus a. So in this case, the function which transforms x is linear. So in this case, the function might be non-linear. And this is done in the static case. Static case is done in paper by Heyer, myself, and Schmutz. And this was done in relation to group risk, to risk of groups. So if one wants to assess if x are capital of group members, then somehow the possible transfers between group members sometimes are non-linear and quite often are non-linear in X. And this is example of
there is a certain duality theory, so this some paths and some
but dynamic cases is not done here. Dynamic case is not done here. The dynamic case is not done here. So it's static.
Reality is a bit more sophisticated than...
Absolutely, because... Yeah.
Uh-huh. Difference, but nevertheless, such theory was developed, as I told, by Dipstick-Nemeth for many years. And so it should be probably extended to certain...
Well, hopefully, if health allows.
Okay, thank you very much. So, any other question?
Your theorem on slide number 23. Does it have a converse? One before? It is if you start with little r, and then you have these properties. How about the other way around? If you start with these properties?
Yeah, one can always recover little r. So it's all right. One can always recover little r by using the argument being the quadrant.
Being what?
The quadrant, shifted quadrant, translated quadrant. And so then one immediately goes back.
So thank you again. So, pass on to the next speaker. Okay.